Hi, my name is Dr. Justin Ramsdell, and I'm Assistant Professor of Psychology here at George Mason University. I'm also a forensic psychologist. I'm here today to tell you a story that outlines some things that you're going to need to know about criminal responsibility. Criminal responsibility can also be referred to as criminal insanity. Whether we're talking about the term criminal insanity or the term criminal responsibility doesn't matter for us. We're going to use each of them interchangeably. However, jurisdictions vary jurisdiction by jurisdiction on which term they use. When you hear of someone pleading not guilty by reason of insanity, they're talking about either criminal responsibility or criminal insanity. The question we're going to answer today is, are there times when an individual should not be held responsible for a crime that we know they've committed?
Spoiler alert. People have a tendency to be opinionated about this and often disagree.
People have been trying to answer this question for a long time. As early as 630 BC, Babylonian law stated,
"A deaf mute, an idiot, and a minor are awkward to deal with, as he who injures them is liable, whereas if they injure others, they are exempt."
At that time, idiot was the word used to describe someone with what we would now call an intellectual disability. More specifically, someone with the intellectual capacity of a 3-year-old. It's not an idiot like you and I understand it. In fact, even in 2006, the word idiot was still listed in the California Penal Code as, quote, one of the 6 types of people who are not capable of committing crimes.
"I'm sorry, Your Honor. I shot that other guy because I was an idiot."
"I had a strong suspicion that you might be an idiot. Thanks for letting us know. Try not to be so much of an idiot next time."
That's just not going to happen. But the Babylonians weren't the only ones wrestling with this question. In the 1700s, British law stated,
"The madness of the insane is punishment enough. In criminal cases, therefore, idiots and lunatics are not chargeable for their own act, if committed when under these incapacities."
Interestingly, British law seemed to state there are times when someone diagnosed with a severe mental illness may be responsible for their actions. That's why they added the sentence, "if committed under these incapacities," to their statute. Now, this can be complicated to understand, but to explain it, I want to introduce you to Sherman. Sherman is a 22-year-old male living at home with his parents, who are both employed in full-time jobs. Sherman graduated high school and attempted college, but during his sophomore year, he began experiencing auditory hallucinations and delusions. When Sherman is taking his medications, he spends his days at home while his parents are at work. He generally watches TV, takes care of the family dog, and several days a week, he works for people in the neighborhood doing light lawn maintenance. One day, Sherman is mowing the lawn of a neighbor's house, and an employee from the cable company stops by the neighbor's house to deliver a new cable box. As Sherman is mowing the lawn, a piece of yard debris from the mower flies out and hits the cable guy. The cable guy doesn't necessarily have what we would call a mature reaction.
What the f***?
It's not an ideal reaction. But Sherman, who's hot, tired, and thirsty, doesn't even notice that the piece of debris flew out of the lawnmower and hit the cable guy. Now the cable guy comes limping over in pain and starts yelling at Sherman. The two start arguing and things escalate. Then Sherman clocks the cable guy in the face. A neighbor who's watching the whole thing calls the police. When the police arrive, Sherman gets arrested, and the lawn's left tragically half-finished.
"Man, that guy totally deserved it. He starts yelling at me for no reason, interrupting me when I work."
Remember, Sherman's diagnosed with schizophrenia. Does that mean that we should not hold him responsible for punching the cable guy in the face? Of course not. It's possible for someone to be diagnosed with schizophrenia and be angry for reasons that have nothing to do with their diagnosis of schizophrenia. The same way it's possible for someone to be diagnosed with type 1 diabetes and punch someone because they were angry. But what if the situation were a bit different? As I mentioned before, Sherman is diagnosed with schizophrenia and is experiencing hallucinations and delusions. Hallucinations in patients diagnosed with schizophrenia are typically auditory. This means that Sherman is hearing a voice or voices that sound like my voice does to you right now. These voices are typically commenting on what he's doing or telling him what to do and giving him commands. Sherman also experiences delusions. These are fixed false beliefs. They're based in reality, but they're a misrepresentation of reality. Sherman's delusions involve the cable company and thought control. He legitimately believes that the cable company has brainwashed his parents through the television so that they are under the company's control. He spends his evening monitoring the messages that are coming through the television so that he can try and protect his parents. He also lies in bed worrying about what his parents might do while under the control of the cable company. He is completely preoccupied with the idea that the cable company is taking over his house and neighborhood and will force his parents to hurt him if he refuses to be brainwashed the same way. Take a second to think about what this must be like for Sherman. He genuinely believes that his parents, who he loves and adores, are under the control of the cable company. He spends his days monitoring the television, trying to figure out what messages they're getting. He lies in bed at night, nervous, thinking about what he can do to help his family. He's paranoid and anxious, monitoring all the messages that are coming in, trying to figure out who's in on the conspiracy and who isn't on the conspiracy, and how he can protect his parents. Think about it. If your house was on fire and someone you loved was inside, would you try and find a way to save them? A lot of people would. Sherman worries about his family and friends the same way you would worry about your loved ones trapped inside a burning building. So, armed with this new information, let's go back and look at the lawn mowing situation again. This time, the same thing happens, except Sherman notices the cable van pulling up to the house. With Sherman's delusions about the cable company, he's going to be vigilant and notice a cable van pulling up to the house where he happens to be mowing the lawn. Imagine how Sherman must feel when that cable van pulls up. He's on edge. He's watching everything the cable man's doing as he's walking towards the house. He's paying such close attention to the cable man that he doesn't notice that his lawnmower kicked out a piece of debris that hit the cable guy. Except now, when the cable guy walks over in an angry and threatening way, that behavior is going to be interpreted in a completely different manner by Sherman. Sherman is going to interpret the angry approach of the cable guy through his own delusional lens. Sherman is going to think that the cable guy knows that Sherman is the last person in the neighborhood that isn't brainwashed. For Sherman, this is the sum of all fears. The cable company knows that he's the last person that hasn't been brainwashed yet. Sherman thinks he's the only person that can save his neighborhood. So he attacks the cable guy, thinking he's defending his neighborhood. Sherman attacks the cable guy with all of the energy and passion that you would put into saving a loved one from a burning building. Sherman sees this as a chance to end the torment from the cable company. So he does it by grabbing a brick from the yard and repeatedly bashing the cable guy in the head with it. Just like in our previous situation, the police are called. And when they arrive, Sherman is still beating the cable guy with a brick. The police have to pull Sherman off the cable guy. But this time, when the police officers arrive and attempt to subdue Sherman, he starts fighting the police officers. I mean, after all, they're interrupting his attempt to try and save his family.
Why won't you just let me kill him? He is controlling my parents. He's coming for you too. I can save us all and make this stop.
While Sherman is in the police car, in front of the police, he is still screaming, kicking, fighting to get out, and finally kill the cable guy. So is there a difference between the first scenario and the second? You bet. In the second scenario, we've got a question about Sherman's criminal responsibility. In a sense, should Sherman go to prison? Or should Sherman go to a maximum security mental hospital? Should we punish Sherman? Or should we treat Sherman? Can we do both? Should the cable guy get a say? What do we as a society need in order for us to feel safe? These are difficult questions to answer. The Babylonians, the British, they all tried to answer the same question, and we're struggling with it now. As we move forward in the lesson, We've got some guides, some legal statutes to help us answer these questions, and you're going to get some practice with that as we move forward.